Hi there, everyone. Welcome to The Daily Gardener. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling. It's the 9th of April. Today's thought is exactly that, how we think when we garden. Emerson wrote, "Blame me not, laborious band, for the idle flowers I brought. Every aster in my hand comes back laden with a thought." How wonderful our gardens are for thinking creatively, therapeutically, soulfully. Every bloom can be a vessel for an idea, a hurt, a solution. I had a fight with my daughter the other day. We were getting nowhere. Exasperated and just plain tired, I had her help me with the houseplants. In case you're wondering, we were spring cleaning all the greens, even the fake ones. There was no talk, no more disagreement, just the plants and water and a little soap and our thoughts. Before we knew it, we were ready to come together. Our welfare and happiness restored by the thoughts knit together in the company of plants. Here are today's brevities. British botanist, author, pragmatist, and survivor Phebe Lankaster died today in 1900. She was born tomorrow in 1825. Born Phebe Pope, she married the naturalist Edwin Lankester, who was a coroner and a medical reformer. They had 11 children, and when Phebe was 49, Edwin died. And you can imagine the predicament she was in. She had to keep producing work to take care of herself and her family. Phebe Lankaster wrote under a number of pseudonyms. Her books were published under the name Mrs. Lankaster. She wrote a syndicated column under the signature Penelope for 20 years. Her energy and work brought friendships with the celebrities of her day, painters, actors, intellectuals, and writers. In 1895, the painter Herman Herkomer painted a wonderful portrait of Phebe Lankaster, her wit and warmth captured on the canvas. Lankaster's work appealed to the masses. She wrote in a friendly and conversational voice, and she wrote about what she knew: plants, educating children about health, and being financially smart. Her books ranged from A Plain and Easy Account of the British Ferns to The National Thrift Reader. And it was the widowed Phebe Lankaster who said, "Often the most thrifty persons are the most generous because they can afford to be so." Phebe often partnered with illustrator James Sowerby, and she worked with him on her sweet little book, Wildflowers Worth Notice. It was noted that Lankaster herself says in her charming preface, "What flowers are not worth notice?" Reviewers were happy with her selections, calling them the special delight of flower gatherers, as for example, the sundew, the mistletoe, the bog pimpernel, the grass of Parnassus, white water lily, and so on. On the last page of her book, Lankaster confesses she had thought about writing a book like this many times, but lacked the courage because she didn't want to offend. She wrote, "Having now gone over the collection of wildflowers, endeavoring to chronicle the chief attractions and virtues of each, I can but feel how little has been said when compared with all that remains unsaid but felt." It's the birthday of Joseph Trimble Rothrock, born today in 1839. Plagued by sickness as a child, Rothrock felt the call of the outdoors. "I just had to go to the woods," he recalled. "Throughout my entire life, I have sought the out-of-doors as a refuge against impending physical ills." Rothrock went to Harvard, and he worked every day in the private herbarium of Asa Gray, who visited Rothrock's hometown to collect botanical specimens. Of Dr. Gray, Rothrock said, "He was kindness personified, though a strict disciplinarian and a most merciless critic of a student's work. I owe more to him than any other man, and I never think of him without veneration." He also studied geology under Louis Agassiz, who became his friend. Agassiz's motto was, "Study nature, not books." Rothrock suspended his studies at Harvard to fight in the Civil War. His right thigh and hand were wounded at Fredericksburg in 1862. He shook hands with President Lincoln at an army hospital. Rothrock attempted to return to Harvard, but discovered that his professors, including Asa Gray, had formed a military company and wanted to serve in the Civil War. Rothrock insisted that Dr. Gray was too old to serve. He took his place in the company and served for another 3 months. Rothrock taught botany and went on to become a surgeon. His passion for forestry ignited when he was named a Michaux Lecturer on Forestry, and he took a 9-month sabbatical under renowned botanist Anton de Berry at the University of Strasbourg in Germany. Destructive forest fires were all too common during the logging era, and long before Smokey the Bear, Rothrock led the effort to prevent forest fires. Rothrock's relentless focus on forestry aimed at making policy change. In 1901, he wrote, 20 years ago, I began agitation upon the forestry question, and I've kept at it ever since. You have no idea the amount of work it requires to change a generation from tree destroyers to tree restorers. It is something akin to a second birth. Later in his life, in a photograph of Rothrock called The Old White Pine and the Father of Forestry, he stands in front of the trunk of a huge white pine with his signature long white beard and kind affect. The gentle expert's right hand is grasping a walking stick. And the photo notes mention that his right little finger was amputated at Fredericksburg. The French poet Charles Baudelaire was born on this day in 1821. He said, "A book is a garden, an orchard, a storehouse, a party, a company by the way, a counselor, a multitude of counselors." Today's book recommendation is The Wildflowers Workbook, a journal for self-discovery in nature by New York Times bestselling author and artist Katie Daisy. This simple and sweet journal features thoughtful prompts to encourage engagement with the natural world. Today's chore is to take inspiration from Phebe Lankaster and buy some wildflowers for your garden. Chicory, hepatica, Dutchman's breeches, Indian paintbrush. Let their charm flood your garden. Here's a sweet diary entry for today by Canadian naturalist Joseph Sariel from 1938, shared by the Toronto Archives on their fabulous Twitter feed, a wonderful thing to follow. There are 5 frames in all, 3 for herbs, 2 for wildflower seeding. The frames are 3 feet by 3 feet. In each section and prior to planting, I can duplicate the exact growing conditions of the subject. It will be quite possible to fill the spaces with soil, moss, bog, etc., taken from locations where the plants to be seeded are now growing or have been known to grow. Thus, a few frames can represent a whole wildflower garden in seed. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced weekdays in lovely Maple Grove, Minnesota. You can find complete show notes over at thedailygardener.org. And be sure to share the show with your garden friends. You can find The Daily Gardener on social media, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And while you're over at Facebook, don't forget to join The Daily Gardener community. Just search for The Daily Gardener community on Facebook and request to join. And finally, a special thank you to my team at Podfly Productions, where my editor is Eric Begay.